हेलो गाइस, दिस इज सत्यजीत पटनायक एंड वेलकम बैक टू माय चैनल। टुडेज टॉपिक इज गोइंग टू बी ऑन डेटा एनकोडिंग टेक्निक्स। एंड टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस टॉपिक यू आल्सो नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज एक्सप्लोरेटरी डेटा एनालिसिस। Yesterday, I had a live webinar on EDA where I explained everything about the business understanding of the use case, what are the different EDA processes, how to handle categorical data, how to handle numerical data, how to handle missing values, little bit about outlier detections, outlier algorithms, and we also talked about some feature scaling techniques, and then we had hands-on use case understanding as well. Hands-on practical parts. So in case you haven't watched that video, probably you go to my channel and watch it and then come here, because that's going to be very relevant for this understanding. So today's topic is going to be on data encoding techniques. So let's get started. Now, as we already know, that data is basically of two types, right? It could be numerical data and it could be categorical data. And ultimately, we have to convert everything to numericals before feeding the data to the models. Because ultimately, computers and models will understand just the numerical data, right? So let's go through the introduction first, and then I'll show you how to deal with the categorical data. The performance of a machine learning model not only depends on the model and the hyperparameters, but also on how we process and feed different types of variables to the model, right? Since most machine learning models only accept, not most, all of them accept numerical variables, pre-processing the categorical variables becomes one of the necessary steps, and it's very important step as well, because most of the times we don't understand what techniques do we use to make it look good, or which should be better for the model building part, right? So we need to convert this categorical variables to numbers so that the model is able to understand and extract the necessary information from the data. A typical data scientist spends around 70 to 80% of his time cleaning and preparing the data, and converting categorical data is an unavoidable activity because that's a mandate feature, that's a mandate activity which we need to do as a data scientist. It not only elevates the model quality, but also helps in better feature engineering. Now the question is, how do we proceed? Which categorical data encoding method should we use? Because I'm not pretty sure, but many people use one-hot encoding, or some of them use label encoders. But there are a lot of encoding techniques people are not aware of. So this video is all about that. We'll try to understand what are the different techniques that are available. This is going to be the agenda. What is categorical variable analysis? What are the different types of encoding techniques like label encoders, OHE, dummy encoding, effect encoding, binary encoding, and some other encoding techniques like hash encoding and target encoding. And we'll also see how to deal with these kind of data. So as we already know, the basics data is of two types. One of them is the numerical data, and the second one is the categorical data. So numerical data again could be of two types. It could be discrete or it could be continuous as well. So we are not concerned about the numerical data right now. We will be more focused on the categorical data. So if you look at the categorical data, there are two types of categorical data. One is nominal and one is ordinal. Now, just try to understand, because before dealing with the encoding techniques, we need to understand the data first. Okay. Now, nominal data is basically, let's say you have gender, male or female. Let's say you have geography, Mumbai, Kolkata, Hyderabad. These are your nominal data. How to deal with it? There are different strategies to deal with it. Let's say your data is ordinal. Now, ordinal basically means if it is in a specific order. For example, primary, secondary, and tertiary, then graduation, post-graduation, PhD. This is in a specific order. Okay, so once you understand the type of data, then we can probably take some decisions with respect to the encoding techniques. Now, feature encoding basically helps us to transform the categorical data into numerical data. Okay, these are just few of them. Label encoding, it's one of the techniques to transform categorical data into numerical data by assigning a numerical value. For example, you have Mumbai, Kolkata, Delhi, just randomly assign 1, 2, and 3 here. Now, that's one of the ways, but obviously it has its own demerits. Because if you assign random numbers, probably when you feed the data to the models, the model might mistreat the numbers, because Delhi is having 3, so it might give higher priorities to Delhi. So there will be a lot of miscommunication or misinformation being passed to the model when we are using label encoding blindly. Okay, so in that case, probably one-hot encoding or dummy encoding could be a better option. Now, what is one-hot encoding? This technique is used when independent variables are nominal. Okay, it creates k different columns, each for one category. Now, for example, I have three valid values, Mumbai, Delhi, and Kolkata. So what it does is it creates three new features, three new columns, city underscore Kolkata, city underscore Delhi, city underscore Mumbai. Okay, I'll talk about that when we go ahead in the next slides. Target encoding. In target encoding, we calculate the average of the dependent variable for each category and replace the categorical variable with the mean value. Hash encoding again uses some hashing algorithms. There are multiple hashing algorithms, right? MD, MD2, MD5. So based on some hashing algorithm, it basically converts the data. Now, one good point about hash encoding is that, let's say you have 1,000 valid values in city column. Let's say in city, you have 1,000 values. Now, if you convert that data into one-hot encoding, you probably will have 1,000 features. That could also cost you, because when it comes to your model building, your computation power will be very high because it will have 1,000 features. So in those cases, you can probably cut down the categorical variables to some other categorical variables, or else you can probably use the hash encoders. Hash encoders basically gives you it gives you the relaxation on creation of number of features. Let's say your city has 5 values, Kolkata, Mumbai, Delhi, Hyderabad, Bhubaneswar. You can create 5 output variables from it, 5 output columns from it. If it is having 1,000 variables, you can also create 5 columns out of it. So that's a feature. Okay, but we'll also talk about some demerits of hash encoder, because when you do that, there is a probability of collision. Okay, I'll talk about that in the future slides. Now let's try to understand label encoders. Now label encoder, I already told that it's going to be used for ordinal data, and hence label encoding is used. It's also called as ordinal encoding. You have color codes, red, yellow, and green, and you arbitrarily pass it as 1, 2, and 3. Okay. Now obviously the demerits of it, you already know that green will be mistreated by the model as highest priority and all those things. So the better way of dealing with this data would be one-hot encoding. So label encoders are mostly used for dependent variables, for Y variables, or else if you have ordinal data. Okay, if you have data in order, then you can go for 1, 2, and 3 or 4, 5, something like that. Okay, what is one-hot encoding? You can see this particular explanation, you'll try to understand that this is basically used for nominal data. And output is always in the forms of zeros and ones. So it is always interpreted properly by the models. When you pass this data to the model, they properly treat it. But again, it has its own demerits, we'll talk about that. Now, here I have color, red, yellow, and green. So what we are doing is we are creating 3 features out of it. Color underscore red, color underscore yellow, and color underscore green. The name could be anything. So let's say for the first row, it is red. So my red column is having 1 and the other columns are having 0, 0. Similarly, second row is red. So red will be having 1 and others will have 0, 0. So this is how one-hot encoding works. Now, there is a concept of dummy traps as well, because these columns are basically called as dummy variables. Red, yellow, and green are called as dummy variables. Okay. Now, one-hot encoding and dummy encoding are very close to each other. Now, there is a concept of dummy trap. Okay. Now, what is dummy trap? If I just ignore this green column, just think that green column is not available. So, for red, we know red is going to be 1, yellow is 0. So, obviously, if I have the third column, I know that its value is going to be 0. Right, for example, this one, green, for green, the first row will be 0, the second first column will be 0, second column will be 0, and I know that the third column is going to be 1. So adding the third column or not adding the third column is not going to add values to the model. So it's always advisable when you convert one-hot encoding or you convert dummy variables out of it, you always try to ignore one of them. So let's say your color column has 5 valid values, so it's always advisable to have 4 independent variables and ignore any of the independent variables randomly. Okay, So if I ignore this green column, that is basically what dummy encoding is all about. Sorry, dummy encoding. So very similar to OHE, but instead of n, we have n minus one features. In one-hot encoding, this is the output. In dummy encoding, this is the output. Okay, you can see here, the second graph will be more explanatory. Red, yellow, and green. I have just ignored the green column because if first is one, second is zero, obviously I know the third is zero, right? So what are the advantages of ignoring one of the columns? Instead of n, you are training n minus one features. So computationally, your model will be less expensive as compared to one OHE, right? That's the only advantage of dummy encoding. Let's move ahead to the next part, which is effect encoding. Also called as deviation encoding or sum encoding. Okay, it's very similar to dummy encoding. The only difference is that the rows which is having just zeros. Now, in this case, this row, this green row is having zero and zero, right? In effect encoding, what we do is we convert it into minus one and minus one. Now, what are the advantages if you ask me? There are some advantages because it has been created and it has been seen that it works better as compared to dummy encoding. See, there is no thumb rule in machine learning. So you always have to hit and trial. You have to try this and see if your model deteriorates or your model performs better. Okay. Our next is going to be hash encoding. Now, hashing is the transformation of arbitrary size input. Now, it basically uses some hash algorithms. Okay, if you don't know about hash algorithms, probably you should spend some time understanding the different hash algorithms because we have multiple hashing techniques like MD, MD2, MD5, SHA. So these are some hashing techniques which are being used. So using those techniques, just like one-hot encoding, the hash encoder represents categorical features using the new dimensions. But the only advantage of hash encoding is that here the user can fix the number of dimensions after transformation using n component. For example, your color column has 10 variables. If you convert it into one-hot encoding, you will have 10 columns. If you do it using dummy encoding, you will have 9 columns. If you do using hash encoding, you could have n columns. You have to define that when you are coding. You can see this here. I have called the hashing encoder. I have called on which column I'm going to implement this. And my n components is 6. That means I want 6 new columns. Even if you have 1,000 variables, you can also do that. You can use n components as 6 or 5. So irrespective of the number of valid values, you can define how many columns you are going to have. So now, since hashing algorithms transforms the data in lesser dimensions, it may also lead to loss of information. Okay, so another issue faced by hashing encoder is called as collision. Now, what is collision? Because here we are converting a large number of features into lesser dimensions. Hence, multiple values can be represented by the same hash value. This is known as collision. Okay. Moreover, hashing encoders has been successful in some Kaggle competitions. I have also seen that. It is a great to try if the dataset is having cardinality features. Okay. So you can try it out and see if your model is deteriorating or model is performing better. Okay. Our next topic is going to be binary encoding. Now, binary encoding is a combination of hash encoding and one-hot encoding. Okay. Binary encoding works really well when there are high number of categories. You can see this particular thing. For example, the cities in the country where a company supplies its products. You can see here, color, yellow, red, green, and yellow. So here, using the binary encoding, I'm using the fit transformation method, and this is how it looks like. Binary encodings. We'll also talk about the coding part and see how it is different from each other. Now, what is target encoding? Now, target encoding is a Bayesian encoding technique. One second. Okay. In target encoding, we calculate the mean of the target value. We are calculating the mean of the target value for each category and replace the categorical variable with the mean value. Okay. In the case of categorical target variables, the posterior probability of the target replaces each category. Now, what happens here is it is using some target encoding techniques, using some Bayesian techniques, and this is how it is transforming the data into a new numerical variable. Okay. Now, if your question would be which technique is going to be the best technique, so it's always recommended to do a hit and trial on your encoding techniques and see which one is performing better. But if you are having less number of features, probably you can go for dummy encoding. If you are having very high amount of features, you can probably go ahead with the hash encoding and see how your model behaves. But it has normally been seen 90% of the people use one hot encoding with the drop last column as true. That means they are by default using the dummy encoding technique. Okay. And also it all depends upon your analysis, because for example, one of the scenarios is you can also make use of the derived metrics. For example, if you are having a column such as domain knowledge plays a vital role. Let's say you have a column such as, I have already explained here, Mumbai, Delhi, Hyderabad, Bhubaneswar, Thiruvananthapuram, something like that. So what you can do is, using your domain knowledge, you know where these cities are in the Indian map. So what you can do is you can probably divide the data into zones: north zone, east zone, west zone, south zone, and central zone. Okay. And probably instead of 1,000 variables, you will have now 5 variables. So you don't have to think about which technique to use, because you are having limited variables. You can go ahead and do a dummy encoding and probably get the final output out of it. So there is no hit and trial. There is no thumb rule for which technique should you work. But yeah, it all depends upon your experience. Once you get started with it, you will probably have your own set of rules, and based on your intuitions, you can probably get started with which technique to use. Okay, that's it for today's video. I will quickly jump into the coding part. It's a very small file, I would say. I will also leave this file to you so that you can check it out. So here what I'm doing is, I will just, let me just, okay. So here I'm using the category encoders library. I have defined a data frame where I have given degree as high school, master's, diploma, bachelor's, bachelor's two times, master's, something like that. And here I'm calling the ordinal encoder, which is my label encoder. Or else you can also use the replace functions. Replace functions also is basically the label encoding part. Okay, so here I'm replacing none with zero, high school with one, diploma with two, something like that. If I run this, this is how the data looks like. Not pretty sure why it is taking so much of time, but let's wait for a couple of minutes. Okay, I'm not pretty sure. So yeah, let it run. In the meanwhile, I will also talk about the fit and transform method. So here I'm calling the encoder.fit transformation, and you can see the degree has changed to values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, something like that. So here we have values till 5, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And this is how the label encoding has been done. It's very simple. You are just assigning some numbers to the columns, column values. That's it. When it comes to one hot encoding, let's say you have color as yellow, red, green, green, yellow. So what happens is, if I just take help of MS Paint, this is how it looks like. So I have yellow, I have red, I have green, and I have yellow. So what is happening is, I am creating yellow, red, green. So there are three values. So I'm creating three values: yellow, red, and green. So here it will be 1 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 1 0 0 1 and 1 0 0. This is your one hot encoding. Okay, when it comes to dummy encoding, you will just arbitrarily delete one column. Let's say I'm deleting this column, or else you delete this column, whatever it is. So there is something called as drop first equals to true. Or you can also do drop last equals to 2. Okay, it will arbitrarily drop one column. What is effect encoding? You can see in this row, 0, 0, it's just converting the zeros into the rows which is having 0, 0, 0 or something like that. It is converting into minus ones. Hashing encoding, irrespective of the number of values we have, we are passing the n components. So how many columns do we want? So that we are passing. If I pass it here 3, it will probably have call 0, call 1, and call 2. Okay. Similarly, in binary encoding, you can see I'm calling the binary encoder, and I have the column as color, return df true. Here is my data frame, yellow, red, green, green, yellow. And when I'm transforming the data, this is how the binary encoding looks like. Okay. Obviously, your output is going to be in the zeros and one format. Target encoding. Again, target encoding, here I'm calling the target encoder. I have my class, I have my marks, and based on the target encoding, I'm just calling the fit transformation. So here, some mathematical operations are happening, and this is how your output looks like. I don't have for, the, okay, I also have hash encoding. Okay, hash encoding I explained, right? Binary encoding and target. So this is all about the encoding techniques. How you'll have to take these inputs and use it in your use cases, and you will see how your model behaves. That is it for today's video, guys. In case you like, please like, share, and subscribe the video. And in case you haven't watched the EDA webinar so far, you can watch it. And as you already know, I have been coming up with a lot of live webinars every Sunday at 7 p.m. So get connected with me, try to subscribe the channel and hit the notification bell so that you get notified on the future videos as well. That is it from today, from my side. Thank you.